Shakers Church, where our motto is showing and loving God through loving people. We pray that you would want to join us every Sunday, whether it's in person or if it's virtual. We pray that you would hear this dynamic word of God and it would touch you like never before. Now stay tuned for this dynamic word of God. Remember, God loves you and so do we. Be blessed.
I'm so glad this morning that he considers me his friend.
And I worship and adore you, Lord.
I worship and adore you.
Just want to tell you.
Just want to tell
Lord,
you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
More than anything.
More than anything.
Come on and tell him.
But if you got your Bibles, let's go to Jeremiah chapter 18. And we're going to look at verses 3 and 4. Jeremiah chapter 18. And we're going to look at verses 3 through 4. I'm going to read it from the Amplified Version. Well, I'll start with one. It says, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, arise and go to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he was working at the wheel. And the vessel that he was making from clay was spoiled in the hand of the potter. So he made it over, reworking it into another vessel as it seemed good to the potter to make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, says the Lord. Behold, as the clay is in the hand of the potter, so you are in my hand. Do you not know that you are in God's hands right now?
Mm-hmm.
That everything that's going on in your life, he is orchestrating it. Mm-hmm. That he is in charge. And so I want to speak to you this morning from the title of Go See the Potter. Go see the potter. The Lord speaks to Jeremiah, telling him to go to the potter's house. He says, there I want to show you something. And so in this season of your life, God, what God is saying is that you're going to have to reconnect with me.
Okay.
You're going to have to go to the place where I am, because where you were before, I am no longer there. But I want you to come to where I am calling you, because there is something that I must show you. There is something that I want to explain. There is something that I need for you to see, because it is going to help you get to the next place that I have for you. So he tells Jeremiah, he says, look, you got to go down to the potter's house. You're going to have to use some effort. You're going to have to go. You might have to take a journey, but you've got to go to the potter's house, because at his house is where I'm about to show you something. In that place is where I'm about to do something. There is a special place in your life that God is going to create for just you and him. It's going to be a place where just you and him meet. There's a place that just you and him go, because there's some things that he wants to show you and no one else. It was a place that only could be seen by him. He needed to see the potter at work. I want to let you know that in this season of your life, God is saying that not only am I getting ready to do some things in your life and take you into some places and walk you into some new territory, he says, but I want you to be in the front row seat this time. I want you to be a witness of what I'm about to do. See, what God's about to do, he's going to do it open and in front of you. Because he wants you to know that it was nobody else but him that has done this thing. You know, there are some things that God does that you're not really a party to. It just manifests. But in this season, God wants you to see how he works. And so you got to understand that life, sometimes it has a way of adding cracks to our vessel. Anybody ever had a day where it just has fell apart, things begin to happen, and you're like, God, what is happening? It begins to chip away at the joy that you started off with.
Right.
You ever started the morning off excited, like you could just fly? I mean, you just like, you don't feel like you in your 40s or your 50s or 60s. I mean, you just feeling all kind of good, and then a phone call or something happens, and it chips away at the joy, the energy that you just had. Life has a way of doing that. Sometimes it's the choices that we have made or the things that have happened to us. It can easily cause the vessel to change its composition or to change its shape. Life has a way of changing us. You know, you ever saw a kid that was so, you know, growing up, they just smiled so much, was just happy. And as they begin to grow, as life began to happen, as things begin to happen, that happiness that was just born, that was just in them, it begins to fade away. And then when you see them, they're not the same happy person.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because
right.
Something has happened to their vessel.
Right.
Wow. Yeah. What it once could hold, it is no longer holding. Once it was able to be filled or it was able to be used, but now it has cracks and it's leaking. Has anybody ever experienced that? There are times that you have went through life and you're trying to hold it together. You're like, God, I'm trying to hold what I got together, and it seems like it's just not happening.
Help me, Lord.
Some of us are in that situation right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
The vessel begins, it has lost its beauty or its purpose. It's beginning to be faded and it's beginning to be worn. Life has a way of taking from us our value. Sometimes we allow people to take our value.
Right.
Because we don't know how valuable we really are. Mm-hmm. Life has a way of taking our purpose. Sometimes we walk around trying to figure out, what am I here for?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Anybody ever been there? Mm-hmm. And sometimes you know your purpose, but when storms come, you're like, why am I really here?
Right.
Like, what is the purpose? Uh-huh. What is your plan? Because I can't see it beyond what I'm experiencing right now. Has a way of taking our joy or our strength. It can change our purpose. It can affect our destiny. It can make you rethink the assignment that God has for you. I don't know about you, but being a parent and having 7 kids, sometimes I have to rethink this assignment. I'm like, God, listen, I don't know if this is really what you want me to do.
All right, now.
But it's all a part of the process. I'm not going to say marriage. I'm not going to say that, because she'll get me when I get home. But do you have your days? You're like, God, am I really supposed to be married to this person?
That's what I see.
Sometimes there are sins that we have allowed to enter our life that brings the nicks and the cracks,
right,
or it
right.
damages our vessel.
Right.
But the thing is, you have to know where to go to be repaired. And I believe that what God is saying is that in this season of our life, he is bringing us back to a relationship with him, back to the basics, so that we can be repaired. Because some of us, we have been out there trying to hold our own vessel together. Mm-hmm. And God is saying, you don't have the power to hold it together. But you're going to have to come back to me. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to have to do a work. So he tells Jeremiah, he says, Jeremiah, I want you to go. And I want you to see the potter at work. I want you to see him taking something that has been cracked or marred, that was broken down. And I want to see you. I want you to see the potter begin to rework it into something of value. Well, can I tell you, in this season of your life, God is getting ready to reshape you.
Amen.
Some of us, he's getting ready to reassign your assignment. Mm. See, we think that sometimes God has missed it, but God will have you do something to keep you faithful while he's fixing something else that's waiting for you that you don't even know. And then once you've been faithful in what he's called you to, he will then reassign you to something else. But in order to reassign you, he has to remodel you. Because see, he built you for one purpose, to fulfill that job. And now that you've fulfilled it, he now has to remake you so that he can put in you what you need to take on to the next challenge or the next phase of life that he's getting ready to take you to. Can I tell you that some of you he's saying, well done, because you finished one leg of what you were supposed to do. And now he's saying, you're going to have to bear with me. I got to take you back on the potter's wheel. I've got to reshape you, because now I have something else that I'm moving you to. There was a new purpose. There is a destiny. There was another part of the vision you could not see that I'm reshaping you. And so you've got to go back down to the potter's house, because I want to show you what I'm about to do in your life.
All right now.
Woo. The reason he was using Jeremiah is because we know that Jeremiah was a prophet, but Jeremiah was the mouthpiece that God was using to tell Judah, hey, you're in trouble. And so he was taking him to the potter's house because he was saying, hey, I need to let you see what is happening to Judah. At the moment, Judah was not serving God or doing the things that they really should have been doing. They were not listening to God. And so God was saying, hey, I'm going to use a type and shadow of this potter to show you that, hey, I am reworking the clay, because if the clay does not get back on the wheel and let me rework it, what is about to come, Judah will not be able to handle it. And so God was saying, I've got to rework Judah. I've got to rework the clay, because there is some danger that is getting ready to come if they do not repent and come back to me. Mm. See, and when we think of the word or sin, or we think of repent, sometimes it's just a lack of faith. Mm. Yeah. Sometimes God gives us an assignment and we're like, because my mama didn't do it, my daddy didn't do it, grandparents didn't do it, how am I going to do it? That's so then right. We begin to lose faith, and God said, okay, now I need you to come back to the potter's wheel, because I'm going to have to work in you so that I can show you that even though they did not accomplish it, I'm going to use you to accomplish it. Mm-hmm. See, church was never meant to be a place of judgment.
Amen.
We've got to understand that. See, that's why God is, if people watch this, I probably will get in trouble, but that's why God is reworking leadership in his body. Because church was never supposed to be a place of judgment. It was never supposed to be a place of titles. It was never supposed to be a place where the pastors are set up for life and the people perish. See, church was created to be a place of fellowship, mm-hmm. of family,
amen.
Of community. Mm-hmm. So that if you don't have and I have, we're going to have, amen. Because we, yeah. in this community.
Come on now, right? Mm-hmm. Come on.
See, I shouldn't be riding in a Bentley and you don't have a car.
That's right.
It was meant to be a place of safety. Mm-hmm. It was meant to be a place of healing. It was meant to be a place of deliverance. Amen. It was meant to be a place of freedom. It was meant to be a place that you could release and surrender. But it was never supposed to be a place of judgment. Mm-hmm. And so in this season, if you notice, God has been moving certain people off the scene because he said, I'm reworking my body. Mm-hmm. And sometimes some things have to die or be removed in order for God to do what he needs to do.
Amen.
Because if you know in the beginning, he said, my house will be a house of what?
Worship.
Not of a man.
Mm.
Not of a title. Not of a position. Mm. But a place of worship of him.
Amen.
If you look at your life, that's why you've experienced many church hurts.
Mm. Right.
Because there were people who refused to get back on the potter's wheel and allow God to work in their lives so that pride would be removed.
Come on now.
So that envy would be removed. Mm-hmm. So that jealousy would be removed. Mm-hmm. See, all of us, we have the ability to have it. But we've got to constantly be on the wheel. That's why you've got to live a life of repentance. See, it's so easy to say, God, I just repent. There are sometimes I've already said it, you know. You know how you get mad with somebody, you already said it in your head, you just didn't say it.
Right.
But you
right.
got to teach yourself just to be, God, I'm sorry.
Right, right.
And it's that simple. But when you live a life of repentance, God can do anything in your life. Right. And you keep things from being able to fester or being able to grow in your life because your heart is right. That's why David did all the bad things he did, but God still said, well, he's a man of my own right heart. But why? Because he knew how to repent and he had a life of worship. So church was never meant to be a place of judgment, but like we said, a place of healing, a place where God dwells, a place where God resides, a place where the cracks could be fixed or covered. It's a place where we could be reshaped into what the potter wants for our life. He shows Jeremiah the truth. Clay can't tell the potter what it should be. See, for too long, we've been telling God, this is what I want to do.
Right, right.
God is saying, I didn't put in you to do that. I created you to do something different. And so he shows Jeremiah, he says, listen, I want you to see the potter reshaping the clay, meaning that the clay was already in one form. It had already done one thing, but now the potter's going back and adding water. He's adding heat. He's reshaping. He's shaping it. He's changing it because there's something different he wants to do. Some of us, we've been fighting God in this season of our life because he's beginning to change some things that we've been used to. He's changing some things that we've been accustomed to. And so we're fighting him on the wheel saying, no, you can't touch that area of my life because it's worked for me thus far. You can't touch this relationship. You can't touch this door. You can't touch this part of my life because I've held on to it for so long. And what God is saying is that in this season, I'm coming after every area of your life because I've got to change it in order to get you to the place that I want to take you to. Because if I don't change you, there are some things that are waiting for you that you can't handle that will come in the state that you were in. But if you let me reshape you, the things won't be able to get to you because I've already removed the things that would attach itself to you. Is anybody getting what I'm saying this morning? God is trying to spare us from some things that are getting ready to come that were never meant to affect us. But he's got to remove you out of the state you're in and put you into a new place where he needs to take you. So the fire, the pressure that you're experiencing right now in your life, it's there because it's shaping, it's sculpting you. And it's molding you. At times we want to get off the wheel, but we've got to get back on it, or we will never be complete. Mm-hmm. How many of you can lift your hands and say, no, I'm going to be complete. I'm going through what God is causing me to go through. Amen. I'm going to withstand the heat. I'm going to withstand the pressure. Yes, I'm standing on the potter's wheel. Too many times we've gotten off the wheel. Mm-hmm. Myself included. When it got too tough, I said, okay, God, I'm going to take a pause.
Right.
But in order for me to walk into what I've never had and done what I've never done, I'm going to have to stay in the fire. Mm-hmm. Because see, the fire smooths out all the wrinkles. Mm-hmm. And it makes you pliable so that the potter can carve and make designs and do everything he needs to do in your life.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So he tells him in verse 6, he says, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, says the Lord. He says, can I reshape you and show you your purpose? He says, can I not fix what is wrong in your life? Can I not just restore you, but not only restore you, but make you into something new altogether? Somebody ought to lift your hand and say, God, I'm ready to receive the new that you have for me. God, I'm ready for you to remove the cracks in my life. I'm trying to make this simple today because I figured friends and family will come, but we all got to get back to the potter. We've all got to get back to his house. We've all got to get back to that place where we can allow him to reshape us because there's some things he wants to fix in our lives because what we've been trying to hold on to, we can't even hold on to it because there's cracks and things we've allowed to enter in. And he says, I want to clear out all those things. I want to smooth them out. I want to make you where you can withstand, where you can withhold. A lot of us, we pray, God, bless me with wealth. but we got so many cracks and crevices in us, he can't give us wealth because the first million he give us, we'll blow it. We're saying, God, I wanna walk in my anointing. And he's like, in the state that you're in, I can't give it to you because you'll get big in the head. Mm.
Come on now.
Because see, what we've been accustomed to, the other vessels we've hung out with, that's what we saw. And so he said, I've got to do something new in you so that people can see something different because my glory's got to come back to my house. So I'm going to have to reshape you a little bit different. I'm going to have to take you through some rough spots so that when I bless you with the anointing, you understand it's not you, it's me.
Okay.
Come on.
That when I give you the wealth, you just won't go out and try to show off, but you will bless others. You'll be a lender and not a borrower.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
He says, so I have to make you stable. So you've got to go back to the potter's house.
Uh-huh.
You've got to go back and let him work on you so that what I do in your life, what you're asking me to do this time, you can hold it. See, sometimes we ask God to do things as God will give us things just to show us you would never, you couldn't hold it in the first place. You ever have your children, they keep asking for something, you know they're not responsible enough to handle it yet.
Right.
And you keep telling them, no, I'm trying to spare you from something.
Right.
And so then you give it to them anyway just to show them, and then they tear it up, and then they're crying. You're like, but I told you you wasn't ready for it. See, there are some blessings God has for us that are age appropriate, but he's waiting to you to come into right alignment with him so that now he can give it to you.
Yes, right. Yes, yes.
So he says, but no, I can't give it to you if you don't go back down and let me rework on you. Right. See, for years and years, I wanted a Mercedes, but it was only just to flash and to show off. So I would pray and God would not give it to me. I would pray and he wouldn't give it to me. Then I look at other people and say, now I live better than them. I'm more saved than they are. But my motives was wrong.
Right.
So finally I let it go and said, give me a camera and give me some other stuff. And we just moved on with my life and as God began to deal with me. And as he began to deal with my desires and my heart and why I want a thing.
Mm-hmm.
After he dealt with it, then he ended up giving me them. But at the time, I would not have been mature enough or even handle it. Some of the things God wants to give us, we're just not ready to handle it mentally.
Right, right.
But if you go back and let him work on you, that's why he allows you to go through things, because he's trying to work out of you some things so that you can get what you really want.
Right.
So I can tell him myself, yes, I dealt with some pride and some other things. Now I got them and I don't even wash them and take care of them. Like, I mean, I take care of them, but I don't really want, I don't, because it doesn't run me. See, God wants to bless you, but he wants to make sure that the blessing does not run you.
Right.
But that you are able to handle it. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
So he says, behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in the house of Israel. He says, don't forget the reshaping and the assignment. He says, the challenges of something new, because you are in my hands. Can I tell you this morning that you are in God's hands and you are getting ready to enter your best days, but you've got to go back to the wheel. You've got to go back to praying. You've got to go back to fasting and seeking God. You're going to have to go back to travailing. You're going to have to go back to your first love. You know how you used to wake up in the morning and you couldn't wait to talk to God? You know how you couldn't even go to sleep because you were so excited to talk to him? You're like, God, I'm trying to go to sleep. Come on, you know, you had those days where you didn't mind coming to church. You didn't mind lifting your hands. You didn't mind testifying of his goodness. You didn't mind dancing before him. You didn't mind singing. He wants to get you back to that place.
Amen. That's right. That's right.
Because life has a way of stealing your praise.
Uh-huh.
It has a way of stealing the worship you have for God. It has a way of keeping your mouth closed. Remember, I told you a couple years ago, we entered into the year of the mouth, which is the time that you're supposed to speak what you've been seeing God do. And if you notice, right when it came into the season of being able to use your mouth and begin to really to speak what you've been seeing, then we were hit with COVID and they were telling you to close your mouth. Why would we enter into the decade of the mouth where we're supposed to be speaking and then we get a virus that comes that tells us to close the mouth? Because the enemy knows if you open up your mouth and you begin to release the mysteries and you begin to release the wonders of God, if you begin to release his purposes and his plans, that what you begin to speak, it has to create something.
That's right. That's right.
See, do you not understand that when we talk, every word that I'm saying, it is bouncing somewhere and it will continue to go on and on. Yeah. It has to land somewhere and create something. So if the enemy can hit you enough in your vessel that it begins to crack, that you're trying to just hold it. So I'm not going to praise God over, because every time I praise God, something happens. Every time I believe God, I'm denied. He can get you to a place to where you stop decreeing what you are declaring for your life, that there's nothing that happens for your life, because there's nothing God can work with. There's nothing that can be created. That's why I don't care how bad I get. Even if I don't feel like praising, I lift my hands, or I tell my children, lift your hands for me or something right now.
Right.
Because the enemy knows if he can steal your praise, if he can shut your mouth, that's how the world was created. When God said, let there be, something happened, right?
Amen.
When he said, let there be, something was created. And the Bible says that same power that raised him from the dead is on the inside of us. Then you ought to know that if he could speak and say, let the sun stand here, let the waters come here, let the land divide. If he had the power to do that, then the same power that he had is on the inside of you. But the enemy understands that you have power you're not even aware of. And so he wants you to shut your mouth. He wants you to cover your mouth, because he understands that if you come into the fullness of who God really is and you begin to speak over your family and over your children, there's nothing he can do with the power of God that's in you. So he says, go to the potter house. Watch him work on that clay and rework it. Watch him return it or make something new out of it. He says, because what you are seeing happening before your eyes is the potter is cutting off what the enemy wanted to accomplish with that clay. So he says, run to the potter. He says, because he's waiting at the wheel to show you what you can't see. To show you what you don't see getting ready to happen. See, you're trying to hold on to what you see now. Sometimes you just got to let it go.
That's right.
Because what you don't see is what you really need to see.
Amen.
That the little you've been holding on to doesn't compare to the much that God's about to give you. You've been trying to hold on to an image of what people think about you. I don't care what people think about me. Because as long as he's pleased, I don't have nothing to worry about. Because everything that I need, he will provide for me.
Yes.
Because he's making me into a new vessel where I'm capable and able to handle it.
Hallelujah.
See, there are different types of vessels. There are some you use every day.
Mm-hmm.
There are some you use for special occasions because they're valuable. And so you've got to realize what you are. It's time to walk into what God has for you. But you got to go back to the potter. One of the places that the potter dwells is in his house. We got to get back and go up to the church of God, to the house of God. Because see, when we come together, there's something that happens that sometimes just won't happen in your living room.
Come on.
Because when your faith joins with my faith, when your praise joins with my praise, there is nothing that cannot happen in this place.
Mm-hmm.
When you get excited, as kids, we used to get excited about coming to church because we didn't know what was going to happen.
Right.
Somebody might dance, their wig fall off. I mean, some things were just funny to us. You know, we knew if a certain song played, somebody was going to dance a certain way. I mean, somebody was going to sing something. I mean, it was an excitement because we was like, we just don't know what's going to happen. What's going to take place? You know, what's going on? And now we're not excited about coming to the house of God because we made it about personalities and not his spirit. But he said, I want you to go back to the potter. Because I'm getting ready to change some things. And if you don't go back to the potter when he comes to sweep house, if you're not on the wheel, you're going to be swept away. So I come to encourage you this morning, go back to the potter. Because there's some things he wants to do in your life. He wants to fill every crack. He wants to put you back together better than you were before. He wants to reinforce some things, but also take away some things. Because the potter wants to put you back together again. Every disappointment, everything that you faced that has worn at your vessel, God wants to make you beautiful again. See, one thing about clay, once it's heated up and it goes through the fire, I'm closing, it doesn't remember its former shape. There are some things that God wants to take away from your memory that have been eating at you and tormenting you. He wants you to get back on the wheel so that he can remove those things, that it will never be a memory again. Anybody hear what I'm saying? There's some things we have held on to that you can't take into your next phase of life. Because your vessel can't hold that stuff. Hey, Hawkins used to sing a song. The potter wants to put you back together again. Says, well, in case your situation has turned upside down and all that you've accomplished is now on the ground, you don't have to stay in the state that you're in, because the potter wants put you back together again. Somebody lift your hands.